The first sound in the mornings was the clumping of the mill girls' clogs down the cobbled street. Earlier than that, I suppose, there were factory whistles, which I was never awake to hear. There were generally four of us in the bedroom, and a beastly place it was, with that defiled, impermanent look of rooms that are not serving their rightful purpose. Years earlier, the house had been an ordinary dwelling house, and when the Brookers had taken it and fitted it out as a tripe shop and lodging house, they had inherited some of the more useless pieces of furniture, and had never had the energy to remove them. We were therefore sleeping in what was still recognisably a drawing room. Hanging from the ceiling there was a heavy glass chandelier on which the dust was so thick that it was like fur, and covering most of one wall there was a huge, hideous piece of junk, something between a sideboard and a hall stand, with lots of carving and little drawers and strips of looking-glass, and there was a once gaudy carpet ringed by the slop-pails of years, and two gilt chairs with burst seats, and one of those old-fashioned horsehair armchairs which you slide off when you try to sit on them. The room had been turned into a bedroom by thrusting four squalid beds in among this other wreckage. My bed was in the right-hand corner on the side nearest the door. There was another bed across the foot of it, and jammed hard against it. It had to be in that position to allow the door to open, so that I had to sleep with my legs doubled up. If I straightened them out, I kicked the occupant of the other bed in the small of the back. He was an elderly man named Mr. Riley, a mechanic of sorts and employed on top at one of the coal pits. Luckily, he had to go to work at 5 in the morning, so I could uncoil my legs and have a couple of hours' proper sleep after he was gone. In the bed opposite, there was a Scotch miner who had been injured in a pit accident. A huge chunk of stone pinned him to the ground, and it was a couple of hours before they could lever it off, and had received £500 compensation. He was a big, handsome man of 40, with grizzled hair and a clipped moustache, more like a sergeant-major than a miner, and he would lie in bed till late in the day smoking a short pipe. The other bed was occupied by a succession of commercial travellers, newspaper canvassers and hire-purchase touts, who generally stayed for a couple of nights. It was a double bed, and much the best in the room. I had slept in it myself my first night there, but had been manoeuvred out of it, to make room for another lodger. I believe all newcomers spent their first night in the double bed, which was used, so to speak, as bait. All the windows were kept tight shut, with a red sandbag jammed in the bottom, and in the morning the room stank like a ferret's cage. You did not notice it when you got up, but if you went out of the room and came back, the smell hit you in the face with a smack. I never discovered how many bedrooms the house contained, but strange to say there was a bathroom, dating from before the Brookers' time. Downstairs there was the usual kitchen living room with its huge open range burning night and day. It was lighted only by a skylight, for on one side of it was the shop, and on the other the larder, which opened into some dark subterranean place where the tripe was stored. Partly blocking the door of the larder there was a shapeless sofa, upon which Mrs. Brooker, our landlady, lay permanently ill, festooned in grimy blankets. She had a big, pale, yellow, anxious face. No one knew for certain what was the matter with her. I suspect that her only real trouble was overeating. In front of the fire there was almost always a line of damp washing, and in the middle of the room was the big kitchen table, at which the family and all the lodgers ate. I never saw this table completely uncovered, but I saw its various wrappings at different times. At the bottom, there was a layer of old newspapers stained by Worcester sauce, above that a sheet of sticky white oilcloth, above that a green serge cloth, above that a coarse linen cloth, never changed and seldom taken off. Generally, the crumbs from breakfast were still on the table at supper. I used to get to know individual crumbs by sight, and watch their progress up and down the table from day to day. The shop was a narrow, cold sort of room. On the outside of the window, a few white letters, relics of ancient chocolate advertisements, were scattered like stars. Inside, there was a slab upon which lay the great white folds of tripe, and the grey, flocculent stuff known as black tripe, and the ghostly, translucent feet of pigs, ready boiled. It was the ordinary tripe and pea shop, and not much else was stocked except bread, cigarettes, and tin stuff. Teas were advertised in the window, but if a customer demanded a cup of tea, he was usually put off with excuses. Mr. Brooker, though out of work for 2 years, was a miner by trade, but he and his wife had been keeping shops of various kinds as a sideline all their lives. At one time, they had had a pub, but they had lost their license for allowing gambling on the premises. I doubt whether any of their businesses had ever paid. They were the kind of people who run a business chiefly in order to have something to grumble about. Mr. Brooker was a dark, small-boned, sour, Irish-looking man, and astonishingly dirty. I don't think I ever once saw his hands clean. As Mrs. Brooker was now an invalid, he prepared most of the food, and like all people with permanently dirty hands, he had a peculiarly intimate, lingering manner of handling things. If he gave you a slice of bread and butter, there was always a black thumbprint on it. Even in the early morning when he descended into the mysterious den behind Mrs. Brooker's sofa and fished out the tripe, his hands were already black. I heard dreadful stories from the other lodgers about the place where the tripe was kept. Black beetles were said to swarm there. I do not know how often fresh consignments of tripe were ordered, but it was at long intervals, for Mrs. Brooker used to date events by it. Oh, let me see now. I've had in 3 lots of frozen tripe, since that happened, etc., etc. We lodgers were never given tripe to eat. At the time I imagined that this was because tripe was too expensive. I have since thought that it was merely because we knew too much about it. The Brookers never ate tripe themselves, I noticed. The only permanent lodgers were the Scotch miner, Mr. Riley, 2 old-age pensioners, and an unemployed man on the PAC named Joe. He was the kind of person who has no surname. The Scotch miner was a bore when you got to know him. Like so many unemployed men, he spent too much time reading newspapers, and if you did not head him off, he would discourse for hours about such things as the Yellow Peril, trunk murders, astrology, and the conflict between religion and science. The old-age pensioners had, as usual, been driven from their homes by the means test. They handed their weekly 10 shillings over to the Brookers, and in return got the kind of accommodation you would expect for 10 shillings, that is, a bed in the attic, and meals chiefly of bread and butter. One of them was of superior type, and was dying of some malignant disease, cancer, I believe. He only got out of bed on the days when he went to draw his pension. The other, called by everyone Old Jack, was an ex-miner aged 78, who had worked well over 50 years in the pits. He was alert and intelligent, but curiously enough he seemed only to remember his boyhood experiences and to have forgotten all about the modern mining machinery and improvements. He used to tell me tales of fights with savage horses in the narrow galleries underground. When he heard that I was arranging to go down several coal mines, he was contemptuous, and declared that a man of my size, 6 feet 2½, would never manage the travelling. It was no use telling him that the travelling was better than it used to be. But he was friendly to everyone, and used to give us all a fine shout of good night, boys, as he crawled up the stairs to his bed somewhere under the rafters. What I most admired about Old Jack was that he never cadged. He was generally out of tobacco towards the end of the week, but he always refused to smoke anyone else's. The Brookers had insured the lives of both old-age pensioners with one of the Tanner-a-week companies. It was said that they were overheard anxiously asking the insurance tout how long people lived when they'd got cancer. Joe, like the Scotchman, was a great reader of newspapers and spent almost his entire day in the public library. He was the typical unmarried, unemployed man, a derelict-looking, frankly ragged creature, with a round, almost childish face, on which there was a naively naughty expression. He looked more like a neglected little boy than a grown-up man. I suppose it is the complete lack of responsibility that makes so many of these men look younger than their ages. From Joe's appearance, I took him to be about 28, and was amazed to learn that he was 43. He had a love of resounding phrases, and was very proud of the astuteness with which he had avoided getting married. He often said to me, "Matrimonial change is a big item," evidently feeling this to be a very subtle and portentous remark. His total income was 15 shillings a week, and he paid out 6 or 7 to the Brookers for his bed. I sometimes used to see him making himself a cup of tea over the kitchen fire, but for the rest he got his meals somewhere out of doors. It was mostly slices of bread and marge, and packets of fish and chips, I suppose. Besides these, there was a floating clientele of commercial travellers of the poorer sort, travelling actors, always common in the north because most of the larger pubs hire variety artists at the weekends, and newspaper canvassers. The newspaper canvassers were a type I had never met before. Their jobs seemed to me so hopeless, so appalling, that I wondered how anyone could put up with such a thing when prison was a possible alternative. They were employed mostly by weekly or Sunday papers, and they were sent from town to town, provided with maps and given a list of streets which they had to work each day. If they failed to secure a minimum of 20 orders a day, they got the sack. So long as they kept up their 20 orders a day, they received a small salary, £2 a week, I think. On any order over the 20, they drew a tiny commission. The thing is not so impossible as it sounds, because in working-class districts every family takes in a tuppenny weekly paper and changes it every few weeks. But I doubt whether anyone keeps a job of that kind long. The newspapers engage poor, desperate wretches, out-of-work clerks and commercial travellers and the like, who for a while make frantic efforts and keep their sales up to the minimum. Then, as the deadly work wears them down, they are sacked, and fresh men are taken on. I got to know two who were employed by one of the more notorious weeklies. Both of them were middle-aged men with families to support, and one of them was a grandfather. They were on their feet 10 hours a day, working their appointed streets, and then busy late into the night filling in blank forms for some swindle their paper was running, one of those schemes by which you are given a set of crockery if you take out a 6-week subscription and send a 2-shilling postal order as well. The fat one, the grandfather, used to fall asleep with his head on a pile of forms. Neither of them could afford the pound a week which the Brookers charged for full board. They used to pay a small sum for their beds and make shame-faced meals in a corner of the kitchen off bacon and bread and margarine, which they stored in their suitcases. The Brookers had large numbers of sons and daughters, most of whom had long since fled from home. Some were in Canada, at Canada, as Mrs. Brooker used to put it. There was only one son living nearby, a large pig-like young man employed in a garage, who frequently came to the house for his meals. His wife was there all day with the 2 children, and most of the cooking and laundering was done by her and by Emmy, the fiancée of another son who was in London. Emmy was a fair-haired, sharp-nosed, unhappy-looking girl, who worked at one of the mills for some starvation wage, but nevertheless spent all her evenings in bondage at the Brookers' house. I gathered that their marriage was constantly being postponed and would probably never take place. But Mrs. Brooker had already appropriated Emmy as a daughter-in-law, and nagged her in that peculiar, watchful, loving way that invalids have. The rest of the housework was done, or not done, by Mr. Brooker. Mrs. Brooker seldom rose from her sofa in the kitchen. She spent the night there as well as the day, and was too ill to do anything except eat stupendous meals. It was Mr. Brooker who attended to the shop, gave the lodgers their food, and did out the bedrooms. He was always moving with incredible slowness from one hated job to another. Often the beds were still unmade at 6 in the evening, and at any hour of the day you were liable to meet Mr. Brooker on the stairs carrying a full chamber pot which he gripped with his thumb well over the rim. In the mornings he sat by the fire with a tub of filthy water peeling potatoes at the speed of a slow-motion picture. I never saw anyone who could peel potatoes with quite such an air of brooding resentment. You could see the hatred of this bloody woman's work, as he called it, fermenting inside him, a kind of bitter juice. He was one of those people who can chew their grievances like a cud. Of course, as I was indoors a great deal, I heard all about the Brookers' woes, and how everyone swindled them, and was ungrateful to them, and how the shop did not pay and the lodging-house hardly paid. By local standards they were not so badly off, for in some way I did not understand, Mr. Brooker was dodging the means test and drawing an allowance from the PAC, but their chief pleasure was talking about their grievances to anyone who would listen. Mrs. Brooker used to lament by the hour, lying on her sofa, a soft mound of fat and self-pity, saying the same things over and over again.
"We don't seem to get no customers nowadays. I don't know how it is. The tripe's just a-laying there day after day. Such beautiful tripe it is, too. It does seem hard, don't it now?" etc., etc., etc.
All Mrs. Brooker's laments ended with, "It does seem hard, don't it now?" like the refrain of a ballad. Certainly, it was true that the shop did not pay. The whole place had the unmistakable, dusty, fly-blown air of a business that is going down. But it would have been quite useless to explain to them why nobody came to the shop, even if one had had the face to do it. Neither was capable of understanding that last year's dead blue bottles supine in the shop window are not good for trade. But the thing that really tormented them was the thought of those two old-age pensioners living in their house, usurping floor space, devouring food and paying only 10 shillings a week. I doubt whether they were really losing money over the old-age pensioners, though certainly the profit on 10 shillings a week must have been very small. But in their eyes the two old men were a kind of dreadful parasite, who had fastened on them, and were living on their charity. Old Jack they could just tolerate, because he kept out of doors most of the day, but they really hated the bedridden one, Hooker by name. Mr. Brooker had a queer way of pronouncing his name, without the H and with a long U, Ooker. What tales I heard about old Hooker and his fractiousness, the nuisance of making his bed, the way he wouldn't eat this and wouldn't eat that, his endless ingratitude, and above all, the selfish obstinacy with which he refused to die. The Brookers were quite openly pining for him to die. When that happened, they could at least draw the insurance money. They seemed to feel him there, eating their substance, day after day, as though he had been a living worm in their bowels. Sometimes Mr. Brooker would look up from his potato peeling, catch my eye and jerk his head with a look of inexpressible bitterness towards the ceiling, towards old Hooker's room.
"It's a bugger, ain't it?" he would say.
There was no need to say more. I had heard all about old Hooker's ways already. But the Brookers had grievances of one kind and another, against all their lodgers, myself included, no doubt. Joe, being on the PAC, was practically in the same category as the old-age pensioners. The Scotchman paid £1 a week, but he was indoors most of the day and they didn't like him always hanging round the place, as they put it. The newspaper canvassers were out all day, but the Brookers bore them a grudge for bringing in their own food, And even Mr. Riley, their best lodger, was in disgrace because Mrs. Brooker said that he woke her up when he came downstairs in the mornings. They couldn't, they complained perpetually, get the kind of lodgers they wanted. Good class, commercial gentlemen, who paid full board and were out all day. Their ideal lodger would have been somebody who paid 30 shillings a week and never came indoors except to sleep. I have noticed that people who let lodgings nearly always hate their lodgers. They want their money, but they look on them as intruders and have a curiously watchful, jealous attitude, which at bottom is a determination not to let the lodger make himself too much at home. It is an inevitable result of the bad system by which the lodger has to live in somebody else's house without being one of the family. The meals at the Brookers' house were uniformly disgusting. For breakfast you got 2 rashers of bacon and a pale fried egg, and bread and butter which had often been cut overnight and always had thumb marks on it. However tactfully I tried, I could never induce Mr. Brooker to let me cut my own bread and butter. He would hand it to me, slice by slice, each slice gripped firmly under that broad, black thumb. For dinner, there were generally those threepenny steak puddings which are sold ready-made in tins. These were part of the stock of the shop, I think, and boiled potatoes and rice pudding. For tea, there was more bread and butter, and frayed-looking sweet cakes, which were probably bought as stales from the baker. For supper, there was the pale, flabby Lancashire cheese and biscuits. The Brookers never called these biscuits biscuits. They always referred to them reverently as cream crackers.
"Have another cream cracker, Mr. Riley. You'll like a cream cracker with your cheese."
Thus glozing over the fact that there was only cheese for supper. Several bottles of Worcester sauce and a half-full jar of marmalade lived permanently on the table. It was usual to souse everything, even a piece of cheese with Worcester sauce. But I never saw anyone brave the marmalade jar, which was an unspeakable mass of stickiness and dust. Mrs. Brooker had her meals separately, but also took snacks from any meal that happened to be going, and manoeuvred with great skill for what she called the bottom of the pot, meaning the strongest cup of tea. She had a habit of constantly wiping her mouth on one of her blankets. Towards the end of my stay she took to tearing off strips of newspaper for this purpose, and in the morning the floor was often littered with crumpled-up balls of slimy paper, which lay there for hours. The smell of the kitchen was dreadful, but as with that of the bedroom, you ceased to notice it after a while. It struck me that this place must be fairly normal as lodging houses in the industrial areas go, for on the whole the lodgers did not complain. The only one who ever did so, to my knowledge, was a little black-haired, sharp-nosed cockney, a traveller for a cigarette firm. He'd never been in the north before, and I think that till recently he'd been in better employ, and was used to staying in commercial hotels. This was his first glimpse of really low-class lodgings, the kind of place in which the poor tribe of touts and canvassers have to shelter upon their endless journeys. In the morning, as we were dressing, he had slept in the double bed, of course, I saw him look round the desolate room with a sort of wondering aversion. He caught my eye and suddenly divined that I was a fellow southerner.
"The filthy, bloody bastards," he said feelingly.
After that he packed his suitcase, went downstairs, and with great strength of mind told the Brookers that this was not the kind of house he was accustomed to, and that he was leaving immediately. The Brookers could never understand why. They were astonished and hurt. The ingratitude of it! Leaving them like that for no reason after a single night! Afterwards they discussed it over and over again in all its bearings. It was added to their store of grievances. On the day when there was a full chamber pot under the breakfast table, I decided to leave. The place was beginning to depress me. It was not only the dirt, the smells, and the vile food, but the feeling of stagnant, meaningless decay, of having got down into some subterranean place where people go creeping round and round, just like black beetles, in an endless muddle of slovenly jobs and mean grievances. The most dreadful thing about people like the Brookers is the way they say the same things over and over again. It gives you the feeling that they are not real people at all, but a kind of ghost, forever rehearsing the same futile rigmarole. In the end, Mrs. Brooker's self-pitying talk, always the same complaints over and over, and always ending with the tremulous whine of, "It does seem hard, don't it now?" revolted me even more than her habit of wiping her mouth with bits of newspaper. But it is no use saying that people like the Brookers are just disgusting, and trying to put them out of mind. For they exist in tens and hundreds of thousands. They are one of the characteristic by-products of the modern world. You cannot disregard them if you accept the civilization that produced them. For this is part at least of what industrialism has done for us. Columbus sailed the Atlantic, the first steam engines tottered into motion, the British squares stood firm under the French guns at Waterloo, the one-eyed scoundrels of the 19th century praised God and filled their pockets, and this is where it all led, to labyrinthine slums and dark back kitchens, with sickly aging people creeping round and round them like black beetles. It is a kind of duty to see and smell such places now and again, especially smell them, lest you should forget that they exist, though perhaps it is better not to stay there too long.